Okay, hi everyone, and welcome to tonight's lecture on the book as an object in a digital age by Sam Arthur. Sam is the founding partner and managing director of the publishing platform Nobrow Press, and he's also the founder of the children's book imprint Flying Eye Books. He's also co-founder and director of the East London Comic Arts and Arts Festival and sits on the board of directors of the Association of Illustrators. I'm thrilled to be introducing tonight's lecture, which came about after I took my students to visit the Nobrow headquarters in East London last year. And there we learned about how they develop each of the beautiful books in their collection, working with illustrators and authors to create each book as a unique design project, manipulating printing techniques, paper types, unfolding book formats, and page compositions to find a medium that best tells the story in question. I encourage you all to check out the selection that we have on sale in the South Jury Room after the lecture if you haven't had a chance to look at them already. The graphic novels and illustrated books produced by Nobrow have long been a reference for portfolios produced within the AA. Their ability to tell a story through their visual content with minimal text is something that all architects aspire to. The book as an architectural project is one that has evolved over time from Vitruvius's De Architectura that serves as the earliest record of the classical architectural practice, to Le Corbusier, who published 35 titles over the course of his career and saw the book and the building as equally important forms of architectural practice, to schools like the AA, where we produce publications to disseminate ideas, provocations, and discussions that occur within this building across the world to initiate a much wider conversation. For Vitruvius, the book was an archive and a manual. For Corbusier, it was something between a diary and a manifesto. For the AA, it is a sort of transcript and a new form of conversation. Embedded in each of these books is a part of their creator's identity. To a designer, the book is not just something to be read, but also an object to be designed, a format to be appropriated, and a way to give legitimacy to and distribute their ideas and research, but ultimately it's a form of self-portraiture or autobiography. For the past few years, there's been a false sense of paranoia about the disappearance of the book, with the fear that the printed page would be usurped by the digital. In a lecture this past summer as part of our format lecture series, graphic designer Irma Boom discussed this relationship between the book, the ebook, and the internet, saying that we didn't need to worry about the book's disappearance, since as a more permanent format, its value lies in its existence as a frozen object, encapsulating a moment in time. And unlike a website, it cannot be continually edited. And to be perfectly honest, part of the reason why the book probably appeals to us as architects is because the book has now become more permanent than a building. This begins to introduce what Sam will be discussing tonight, the longevity of the book, even within our increasingly digitized lives. I'm sure, like me, you're all curious to find out more about what Sam has to say, so without any further ado, please join me in welcoming Sam Arthur today.
Thanks a lot. Thank you for coming. Wow, that was quite an intro. There's not much left to say for me, really. I don't even know. Well, what I wanted to do tonight was discuss the book as an object, but also give you a kind of overview of what we do at Nobrow and how we do it, and some of the inspirations that we've had over the years and the reasons why we do things the way we do. And hopefully that's going to feed into this discussion about the relevance of the book as an object in, you know, this digital age. This is just some of the books that we've published over the last 8 years. We set up Nobrow in 2008, I just want to tell you, just give you a really quick overview of, you know, what we are as an office, as a business. This is our propaganda. This is we have two offices, one in London, in Shoreditch, and one in New York. And we've commissioned the red one is the London office. This is an illustration by Jan van der Wieken, and we commissioned it really to show, I guess, what our office was like and what we were about in our dreams. The one on the right is even more fantastical. It's by Luke Pearson, and it shows the Nobrow office is actually that little semicircular window in the middle with someone shouting down the phone, which is actually my business partner, Alex. And if you look very closely, you won't really be able to see it, but I'm is this work? I'm depicted down here looking really jet-lagged and pissed off. So if you can kind of take anything from that you like. That one is by Luke Pearson, I think I said that. So yeah, there we go, we just said that. The office in New York is very small. It's only, it's really two, three people. It's the sales office. America's our biggest market, and without that sales office, we wouldn't be able to take advantage of that. But most of the work happens, design, editorial, production, that all happens in London. We've got 12 staff. It grows and contracts seasonally, but that's a kind of core 12 staff. So a couple of people work part-time. And that's across what I've just said, the design and production, the editorial, sales and marketing, bookkeeping. Who have I forgotten? No, I think that's everybody. Next year, 2016, is going to be our biggest year. So 40 titles for us. Lots of publishers publish a hell of a lot more than that. But for us, the level of work that goes into each book, that's a lot of work. And obviously, we specialize in illustrated books. So we're working with a lot of different illustrators, a lot of different writers too. But we do a lot of work in-house in terms of editorial and design. So this year coming up is going to be big. I tried to figure out how many different artists and illustrators and cartoonists we'd work with. I think it's about that much, but I have no idea really. It's probably more. So it's been a lot of people over the last, since 2008. Is that all right? So, the book as an object. I mean, this is kind of, what drew myself and my business partner into publishing, because neither of us were publishers before we set up Nobrow. I worked in advertising as a commercials director and a music video director for about 10 years, and Alex was an illustrator. And part of the reason, I think, why we decided to go into publishing, and particularly into publishing books, was sheer love of the book as an object, actually. And to really, one of our founding principles is that we want to print books that deserve to be printed. Now, that doesn't mean that we're anti-digital or anything like that at all. If we didn't have the internet, if we didn't have the design applications and the various different apps that we use on a daily basis, it would make our lives much more difficult. So we obviously, that's an integral part to what we do. But the book as an object is something that we really believed should have a future, especially now. When we set up Nobrow, it was actually, there was a lot of talk about Prince is dead. And who's seen Ghostbusters? Most of you, or hardly any of you, actually. You should go and watch it, it's quite a good movie. But Harold Ramis, who actually wrote the script as well and played Egon, he coined the phrase, as far as I'm concerned, print is dead. And as he did this in the movie, he was waving a floppy disk. Does anyone remember floppy disks? Now, the funny thing about that, though, it really is that the digital has, taken us by storm. But there's so many different, digital artifacts that kind of fall by the wayside. And the one thing that continues to remain, is the book. And one of the reasons why I think at this point in time we felt like setting up a print publishing company in particular was just a fear that maybe books would cease to be special. And therefore, we felt like that was what we needed to do, continue to publish books and to make them special enough that people would need them and want them still. Rather than, I guess, the alternative, which is slightly alarmist. And at the time, I think there were a lot of people running around just believing that, you know, we weren't going to have books anymore. But thankfully, it doesn't seem to be the case. And even though all of these devices that we fill our lives with now, as I said before, they are tremendously helpful. And we wouldn't be able to have the reach that we do. We wouldn't be able to work with artists all over the world. We wouldn't be able to have people working remotely for us in Australia or in the, on the west coast of the US or in Chile or in wherever the artists that we work with are. We also, without social media, we wouldn't be able to market our books in quite the way that we can. As a publisher, we are, for Nobrow, a niche publisher. We're publishing graphic novels and design and art books. But these are not necessarily things that you're going to find in W.H. Smith's on the high street. So therefore, we need to find our market. We, even in a way, we need to create our market. And that's something that, that social media has helped us to do to a certain extent. When I was doing a bit of research into this talk, I actually, you know, and thinking about this concept of that digital would almost mean that we can rid ourselves of so many of our possessions and objects, because eventually, you know, we really need could be contained on a hard drive. I mean, to me, that's incredibly depressing. But I did find a couple of individuals and kind of little collectives that really believed in this. One guy had actually sold every single possession that he had. Seemed a slightly flawed procedure in a way, and actually stopped posting on his blog, so I can only assume he sold his laptop as well. But in a way, you know, there is a possibility that everything, you know, could be contained in a cloud and we wouldn't need possessions anymore. I feel like human beings need to surround themselves with a certain amount of junk, and therefore I just can't see this really happening. Michael Landy, I don't know if you remember his artwork breakdown from 2001, which was an amazing piece, and it was, if for those of you who don't know, he actually catalogued every single item that he owned in his universe, and then systematically began the procedure of destroying each and everything through a kind of crushing machine, which he'd installed. I think it was somewhere on Oxford Street. I can't remember now. And it was an amazing art installation. But it kind of, yeah, it just, this idea that we wouldn't have stuff, we wouldn't have things around that represent us, that that enthuse us, I don't know. I don't buy it. I don't think it's going to happen. So this is a new thing, relatively, and it is a challenge to the book. The Kindle and Amazon has brought us this. And it's definitely, you know, pretty good if you want to go on holiday and you don't need a suitcase of books on Ryanair, because it's kind of expensive and you want to put your flip-flops in your bag as well. I think Kindle is a good idea. So that's great. However, Amazon, this is Amazon. What are these things? They're books. This is how Amazon has taken over the world. So whenever I'm thinking about, you know, whether the book has a future, I always have to come back to this idea. You know, the one company that I guess is, for many publishers, is a kind of a scourge on one level and a best friend on another. Amazon, you know, undercuts everybody's prices, but at the same time, it gives us all very easy access to the things that we love. And the biggest thing that it's built on is books. And Amazon has developed an amazing logistical enterprise in getting these objects to us incredibly quickly and efficiently. And also, you know, second-hand books, books that we didn't know existed anymore, books that are discounted beyond belief. They're almost free sometimes. You just have to pay the postage, and sometimes you don't even have to pay that. So, I mean, Amazon is built on books. So this is a strange, strange thing. This is also a thing. I mean, I can't, at first I thought it was just that people were spelling it wrong. But then I realized actually there are loads of people taking pictures of their shelves and hashtagging it shelfie. Just have a look and you'll see thousands and thousands. And most of the shelves that you see will also contain books. So, you know, as an object, I think, you know, we have a love affair with books. They represent a moment in time frozen forever. And that moment might go out of fashion and then come back into fashion again. You know, I'm going to talk about some of our inspirations behind Nobrow in a minute, and you'll kind of see what I mean. But yeah, have a look at Shelfie on Instagram or on what's the other one called? Twitter. So that leads me to this is my Shelfie. Actually, the previous one was my Shelfie. This is my work Shelfie. So this doesn't exist anymore, actually. When we first set up Nobrow, we hadn't published anything yet. If you imagine, if you set up a publishing company, on the first day, you're in your office, sitting at your chair, you have your desk, you've got your pencils neatly laid out, you've got your computer. Maybe there's a manuscript, maybe not. And pot plant, perhaps. Maybe a desk lamp. I don't know, it's all neat and tidy. And then you realize, oh shit, we have to find something to publish. And that is a really difficult moment, because in the end, you need to be selling yourself, not just your books, but you need to be selling yourself to your potential artists and writers. So if you haven't done anything already, it's kind of like what comes first, the chicken or the egg. It's a very difficult scenario to be in, which we suddenly realize. So this photograph was taken in order to really communicate to people what we were about and what we wanted to do. And I guess in the end, it's just a bunch of secondhand books from jumble sales, things that we've collected over the years, old weird toys, bits of ephemera. And it's something that I guess we wanted to say, this is what inspires us. This is what we're about. This is the kind of thing that we want to do. And this communicates what we're going to do. So from that shelf, there's a few books that I want to talk about because I feel like they're quite influential in terms of what we've gone on to do. Kind of sometimes for bizarre reasons. This is Black Bob. It's an annual of comics about a sheepdog taken from the Dandy in the 1960s. Now, I was kind of amazed, actually, when I first saw this annual, that there were enough comics to fill an annual that someone had written about a sheepdog. I guess Lassie was quite popular at the time, so this was a sort of non-equity equivalent of Lassie, I guess. Black Bob was a kind of Scottish sheep dog. To be honest, the comics were kind of boring, but in the annual they have these sort of interstitial pages, and I'm not necessarily particularly into sheep, but if I was, I'd definitely have this on the mantelpiece. The illustrator worked on this stuff for about 10 years. I think his name was Jack Prout. And to do that, I strongly, you know, I believe that he must have absolutely loved what he did. And I think you can tell from the drawing, because this is what I love about this book. Even though I didn't particularly like the comics or the stories, they were a bit dull. There's only so many dry stone walls that, you know, can be built, and barns that can burn down, and people can be rescued from. But these drawings are just really beautiful. And if I'd have known at age, I don't know, 7 or 8, that you could make dynamite from sheep, I think that might have changed my whole outlook on the world. I don't know. And sorry, and just to say, in the end, this guy, he loved what he did, but what he did was draw. And I think that, you know, I went to art school, so did my business partner. It's something that we grew up doing, something that we love to do. It's something that we celebrate in our books. Every book that we publish, the artist has a voice, and that voice is realized through drawing, first and foremost. So that's a real fundamental for what we do. This one is an interesting, they're two books actually. They're both from Japan. I guess they're from the 60s. The gorilla one with the yellow background, when you see this in real life, that yellow color, I promise you, it doesn't look real. I mean, it's unbelievable. It looks also as if perhaps the person who handled the ink in the print factory may not have lasted until the end of the week, because however they got that color, it can't have been safe. It must have been poison in some shape or form. And it's incredible. And for us, one of the things that I look for when we're trying to, you know, make things, is to make something stand out. And this book, it stands out. It's unbelievable. The other book is a Godzilla annual. And we've got two spreads. One of them is what I say, it's CMYK, it's cyan. It's four color process, so it's full color. And the one at the top is actually probably just two colors, so red and black. And I imagine that when they commissioned this book, they probably wanted to save some money by possibly paying the illustrator less money, because it's, if they're working in two colors, I guess they could argue that it was less work than working in full color. And in those days, the illustrators often would have a big part to play in preparing the separations of the artwork for the printer. So yeah, if they were doing full color, then they may have had to do more work. So more work equals more money. Less work equals less money, cheaper. The other thing is they could also say to the printer, well, you know, less ink too, you know, less colors, less ink. So I think they're probably just being super thrifty. But when I look at this book, the image that really stands out to me, the one that I like the best, is the one that's probably had the most restrictions, and that's the red and black image. The illustrators really had to think about how to use those two colors to maximum effect and how to get the most out of that. So, you know, it's a design process as well. It's not just making nice pictures. It's about thinking about how to use the materials, how to use the processes to your advantage. And that's what I love about this book. Who knows about Ladybird books? There's been a few exhibitions recently, and there's a couple of things on TV. Even before Nobrow, I was collecting Ladybird books. They're these little books. I think they started publishing them in the 40s, and actually they're still doing them to a certain degree now. But you can find them on just about any topic. And I got slightly addicted to buying them on eBay at one point. I think it was after a couple of weeks, and my studio was just kind of full of boxes of Ladybird books. And my studio at the time was at home, so my wife pretty much said that she was going to leave me if I didn't stop buying Ladybird books, and that I'd better go out and get a job. So I did, and I stopped buying them, but I've still got a lot of them. And this is one of my favorites. You can also get public services gas and public services water, just in case anyone's interested. I kind of like these ones just because they're so obscure. I mean, there's a lot of famous ones that were more about, you know, were more like nursery rhymes and fairy tales and stuff. But I just love the bizarre kind of nature of some of these non-fiction books. And if we think at the time that they were published, we didn't have the internet, obviously, so this is where we had to learn. As children as well, we had to learn things about electricity. So this is the kind of book we would have learned it in. And as a kid in school in this country in the late 70s and early 80s, the Thatcher years where perhaps we had less money spent on our school books, I kind of became reliant on these in our school library as an educational aid. And they were probably stuck together with sellotape, but they were still going pretty strong. So even though I think probably at the time I thought they were pretty rubbish because they weren't new, they were old, I think there's a nostalgia for me when I look at these books. The other thing though, the other reason that I wanted to mention them is that they're a design classic. It's kind of handy finding this in the bottom of a box when you're just about to start a publishing company and you need to swat up on printing processes, which is exactly what happened, by the way. But one of the amazing things about Ladybird books is that they're only about this big. So if you look at this thing up here, this is called the printer's imposition. I know it just looks like a load of squares to you, but that is actually two sides of the same sheet of paper with all of what's in this book printed on it, and the illustrators actually illustrated that. It's really cool. The printer's imposition, in order for the pages to be folded up, which is what happens, they're all printed on one big sheet of paper. The paper is folded up, and then it's bound, and then it's trimmed. So in order for that to work, all of the pages have a very specific pattern that they must be in on the page, you know, so that some of them are upside down, you know, it's quite confusing when you look at it. Rather than just printing out each page separately and sort of stapling them together, this is how it's done. But what's amazing about Ladybird books is that one sheet of paper equals one book. So even the cover, which is over cardboard, is printed on that sheet of paper, and you can see that's the cover there, and so on the back of the sheet it's blank, and that's the only blank bit of paper on that whole sheet. So isn't that amazing? And from an accounting point of view, it's brilliant as well. If you sell, you know, one book, you've used one sheet of paper, it's actually great. So I found that quite inspiring. And plus, you get amazing illustrations like that. So we'll just look at that for a minute while I have a drink of water. There we go. Okay, so moving on. I want to kind of show you now how some of these things actually influence the way that we do things. So when we first set up Nobrow, we actually set up with a print studio, a silkscreen studio. Sadly, we don't have it anymore because the rent in our studio went up so much that it would have been the most expensive print studio in probably the whole of London. So we donated our screen printing studio to an art school. So at least it's still getting some good use. But in the early days, we took inspiration from the Ladybird books, and we printed our books that we printed by hand on one big sheet of A4. And then we bound them really simply with staples and added a slightly heavier weight cover. And so we were doing things extremely simply. We stamped them on the back. And this is the Bento Bestiary by Ben Newman, and it was the first book, I guess you can say this is the first book we published, even though we only we made 100 of these. But in the early days, this was how we got our aesthetic across quickly to people. These are some of the other books that we made during that those early years. Rather than, I guess, take the risk of publishing into the trade, which is obviously, you know, we're dealing with thousands of copies of something, and taking that risk, we actually decided to concentrate on doing things on a small scale and building a reputation, working with different illustrators and artists, and actually building a brand in a way. So we were able to get these books up online and people could see them, people could order them from our website, and very quickly we actually had a house style, we had an aesthetic. That thing about sitting at the desk, you know, with my pot plant and my pencils neatly arranged, it suddenly, we actually had published something. So we could talk about stuff, we could attract new talent to our publishing house. And that was because we started small, and that's why we call this Nobrow Small Press. And then we moved on to doing the magazine, which was a themed magazine where we approached different illustrators primarily to give their interpretation of a different theme for each issue. So, for example, the first issue, which is your top left, was the theme was gods and monsters. And the only thing that we would ask is that everyone would make a piece of work based on the theme, but also they had to use the colours that we had chosen. The colour palette was very important to us. And if you think back to the Godzilla annual, where the publisher was trying to be very thrifty and not spend too much money, in a way we were doing the similar thing. The first issue that we did was only two colours on white paper. It was black and blue. So we did save a bit of money on the printing. But also we were asking to do, we were asking illustrators to do something essentially for free. And we felt kind of awkward about that in the beginning. But at the same time, we were giving them complete artistic freedom. It was their work, and a big part of Nobrow was about recognizing illustration as an art form and recognizing illustrators as artists, because we really thought some of the editorial things, advertising things that we were seeing were amazing, but what happens when these people get to do their own ideas? What happens when they get to do their own thing in their own time? So that's what Nobrow magazine was all about. And each issue, we chose a different color palette. So we were always using these different color palettes. And when I say using a color palette, I'm not just talking about going into Photoshop and choosing blue and choosing yellow. When we would take something to print, the printer was actually using a Pantone color, which he or she had mixed up in the pot and put that into the machine. So on these in these editions, we used anything from two colors up to six colors. This is just to prove that once upon a time I drew, because now I normally look at spreadsheets and you know, I'm kind of calculating things on a, but this is my work, my illustration from Nobrow Gods and Monsters. So it was based on my local park. Luckily it's not like this anymore. It's London Fields, my local park. So I mean, I'm more likely to get killed by a hipster on a fixed gear bicycle wearing a bobble hat than a sort of rabid, scary dog. But that's good as far as I'm concerned. Anyway, and this is Bjorn Rune Lee's work in that same issue. So he based his work on the Nordic gods. So, and this is Luke Pearson in an issue that we themed Topsy Turvy. Luke has gone on to be, and Bjorn, and some of the other people like John McNaught, who did this for It's Oh So Quiet, was a theme for this one. The magazine was a really amazing way for us to meet people and find artists and illustrators that we felt we could do bigger projects with. And that was something that I guess having the time to develop the magazine has really helped us build our business. So, for example, one of the first books that we published was The Wolf's Whistle by Bjorn Rune, and we'd already worked with him in the magazine. But this was the story, the backstory of the wolf in The Three Little Pigs. So the story is really that the wolf was the good guy and the pigs were the baddies. The pigs were, yeah, pretty nasty pieces of work in this book. And here's a couple of, well, this is a spread. And Bjorn used this kind of limited color palette for this book, and it's really amazing. The illustrations are really beautiful, and the colors look incredible. And actually, it got selected to be part of a book this year, which was the 100 greatest children's books over the last 100 years by Martin Salisbury. So it was kind of an honor to even have a book anywhere near that accolade. So Bjorn must be very proud to have his book in that. And then also we started to play around with formats a little bit. So thinking about the book as object, again, it makes you, I guess, reappraise what is a book. You know, what makes a book specifically a book? I mean, this is what we call a leporello. So the binding, there is no binding. It's just a folded page, I guess. But when it's in its cover, you can read it like a book, or you can take it out and stick it on the wall, or you can put it on the mantelpiece. And something like this, we feel this is a book. This is an object that we can describe as a book. We sell it in bookshops. And actually, booksellers were kind of opposed to it in the beginning, partly because it's difficult to display. If you think about the book trade, a bookshop essentially is completely standardized around the format of a book. So if you give them anything different, then it's gonna be tricky. And I think more and more now, if you walk into bookshops, you actually see gift sections. And it kind of feels weird, actually, when you're in a bookshop and you've got this sort of place where there are all of these non-book objects. It just kind of feels a bit incongruous. And unfortunately, that's part of the business that we kind of have to deal with these days. But for the leporellos, they've really been good for us. And when booksellers realized as well, I think, that you can sell more than one copy, you can sell two copies of the same thing to one person, because if you put if you twizzle one of these round, and they kind of match up so that you've got a very long wall freeze if you've got two copies, and it's continuous. So we've done quite a few of these titles. So there's some of them. That one, incidentally, is Rise and Fall by Mikka Lidberg, who's an illustrator based in the US. Yeah, it's a really beautiful book, and we still have it in print. We also do comics. Again, I think when we started to do comic books, it was with this series called the 17 by 23 series, which describes the dimensions, 17 centimeters by 23 centimeters. But the idea with these was to create a kind of short form comic. In the industry, I guess you'd call it a one shot. So it's a short story with a beginning, a middle, and an end. And it's not necessarily intended to be part of a series or anything. It's a means to an end. And with these books, what we wanted to do was approach people who maybe hadn't worked in comics before. We approached a lot of illustrators that we could see made amazing narratives in their drawings. So we thought it would be interesting experiment to see how they would approach a comic. And that's really where this project came from. And the idea really would be to use this small project as a springboard to something bigger. But also, if you're approaching someone who doesn't necessarily work in that medium, a 24-page short story is actually a lot more achievable than perhaps approaching someone and saying, hey, can you do a graphic novel, you know, like 100 pages, okay? And most people obviously just tell us to go away. But when we were asking people with this short form, I think a lot of people were quite game. So Rob Hunter, for example, the new Ghost, we've just sent it off to print for the, I can't remember, fifth or sixth time. And, you know, this was his first book. He'd never done a comic before. So it was a really, it's a remarkable achievement. And I don't think he necessarily would have done that if we hadn't suggested it to him. And the same goes with a lot of the other people as well. I do want to talk a little bit about print process as well, because, again, you know, a book, as an object, it is, yeah, it's paper, it's glue, it's thread, it's ink, it's card. That's kind of it for most of them. But yet, there's a lot of physical properties that you have to consider. You have to consider how it's going to be bound, you have to consider how it's going to be printed, you have to consider what the materials are. It's not just paper. There's no such thing as just paper. There's all kinds of different papers made from different types of wood pulp, made from different combinations of chalk and pulp, and made in different processes. So a book can be a very variable object, from something quite luxurious to something super disposable. So I want to kind of speak to you a little bit about how we went about our process. This is an offset lithographic printing machine. This one is a 10 color press, which means that if you put paper at the other end and you put it through, you can print 5 colors on one side of the sheet, and the sheet will flip around in the middle of the machine, and then it can print 5 colors on the other side in one pass. Or you could just print 10 colors on the same sheet. Incidentally, this machine was at a printer in South London, which is no longer in business. A lot of printers and printing is obviously, as with a lot of other manufacturing, is done in China and now. And a lot of the printing that we do is actually still in Europe. There's nothing wrong with printers in China, it's just that it's a very long way away. And the way that we work tends to be that we'd rather get our books a bit quicker rather than waiting, you know, for the 3 or 6 weeks, however long it takes for them to ship back to the UK. If we were a bigger business and needed larger quantities, maybe we would have to do things in China. But as it stands, we do things in Europe. It kind of suits us. So you can see that this image is made up of lots of little dots. This is a CMYK image. And CMYK, if you don't know, it's cyan, magenta, yellow, and black. And each conventionally printed color image is made up of these 4 colors, printed in what's called a halftone screen. So that halftone screen is really just a frequency or a sequence of dots of different sizes. When these dots are laid, are printed one on top of the other, because the ink is transparent and because of the optical arrangement of those dots, we actually see what we feel like is the full color spectrum. However, if you can think, you know, the eye sees, you know, the full, what our eye can perceive in terms of the color spectrum, what can be represented from those 4 colors on a sheet of paper is actually radically different. It's quite a kind of limited palette. So if we're trying to print something with these 4 colors, we can make it look pretty good. And in fact, we use this process for a lot of our books. But sometimes we quite like the idea of using different colors that you can't achieve with CMYK. So hence, we started to use Pantone colors and colors that are actually mixed up specially. And that's why they're called special colors sometimes in the trade as well. So this is an image from Nobrow 1, and it's how many colors is this? Does anyone want to tell me? It's by Jordan Crane, by the way. I don't mind, you can guess, it's fine. I'm not gonna come and slap you if you get it wrong. Two? Anyone else? Three? Okay, so it is two, you're right. I just wanted someone else to get it wrong. So in this situation though, it was quite interesting because when we printed this, we were using two colors. Jordan Crane, as it happens, by trade, he makes silk screens prints, and he's a cartoonist as well, and an illustrator. But he really knows what he's doing when it comes to printing. So when he created this image, and it was bearing in mind it was one of the first things that we ever printed, not ourselves, but with a printer. A professional printer. When the printer called me up and said, "Sam, I'm a bit worried. You think you need to come down to the press? Something's not right." And I immediately kind of sort of panicked and ran all the way to the printer, which is in Hackney actually. And then he explained to me, "Look, we're printing with black and blue, but it's coming out of the machine and it's black and it's blue and it's brown, and I just don't understand. And I think something's gone wrong." And I just, oh God, okay. So I'm explaining to the printer kind of color theory all of a sudden. But yeah, it's very deliberate of Jordan. But what he's done, which is really interesting, is used the area of tone that you perceive to be black, I think I've got a close up, is actually the black and the blue printed one over the top of each other. And then the area that looks brown is actually the black on its own. So, if you ever have studied color theory, then you'll probably have that thing that the tutor or the professor or the teacher ringing in your ears that black and white are not colors, they're tones. And this is a really good illustration of that, because whenever we make objects black with black pigment or dye or anything, we can never make them truly black, because truly black would be if we took all of the light out of this room, that would be black. If you can't see anything, that's black. So that doesn't exist as a dye, So when we see black, what we're really seeing is very, very, very dark brown, very, very dark blue, or very, very dark green, or maybe even very, very dark purple. That's what we're seeing, really. And when you see this image, you understand that, because in contrast, the black and the blue printed together just looks denser and darker than the black on its own against the white of the page. And therefore, it's an optical illusion, essentially, when we're seeing black. So now we see it as its true color, which is brown in this instance. And the blue we can use, in half tone or in full tone, and that's what Jordan's done in this image. So he used the colors, the limited color palette, really cleverly. And thinking about that Godzilla image from before, that's again something that I really enjoy. Likewise, when we did the jungle issue of Nobrow, we were working with, this time we thought we'd push the boat out and we'd use three colors instead of two. One of the artists that we worked with was this chap called Mark Herald, and his work arrived one day in a folder through the letterbox. Most people were sending me folders via email, but not Mark. To be honest, when I opened the envelope and pulled out these slightly tatty bits of photocopy paper with bits of other paper stuck to it, and ink and biro, and it was kind of a bit tatty and they'd all been a bit crumpled in the post. I didn't really know what to make of it at all. And I would have emailed him to ask what was going on and what to do with it, but he obviously didn't have an email address. Otherwise he would have emailed it to me in the first place. So I called him up And then I realised he actually didn't have a phone either, because the phone number I'd called was actually his next door neighbour. And it was this old lady that had to go around and knock the door for him. She seemed very happy to do it, but I was kind of slightly strange. Anyway, so 10 minutes later, when he came to the phone, I said, "Hi, Mark, how are you doing?" He said, "Good, did you get the artwork all right?" I said, yeah, it's yeah, I've got it. And I don't really know, what do you want me to do with it? And he said, "I'm really sorry I didn't scan it, but you know, I don't have a scanner." He hasn't got a computer, so I don't know what you do with a scanner anyway. He proceeded to explain that I didn't need to worry, I just needed to scan them all in and use the levels in Photoshop just to turn the black to turn the blue to black wherever it was, and just to level everything out. And I didn't need to worry about registration. Registration is the alignment of the different layers, because he used the same size sheet of paper, and the size of the paper is exactly the right size for the dimensions of the book. I thought, well, that seems oddly simple. You know, there must be something more complicated than this. But actually, we followed his instructions exactly, and this was his image in the magazine. And I mean, it's one of my favorite ones, because you really see, you know, the way his mind was working when he was doing it. But also, what I love about this was that he was using super lo-fi printmaking techniques, and we were essentially applying them to an industrial process of printing, and it made no difference. It's still the same thing. You can still do that. And that's what I thought, wow, that's really cool. You know, whatever jargon we're faced with when we're you know, speaking to printers, or, you know, trying to figure out how to do something in InDesign or Photoshop, at the end of the day, it's the same process that Mark was using in his very own print room to make, you know, various different types of print. So that's kind of heartening. This is shows you Nobrow number 3, I think this was. There you go, number 3. This is by Attack, a illustrator based in Germany. And he also sent us a hard copy of his artwork. So he does his work on what's it called? Printmaker's film. So it's a bit like tracing paper. And on each bit of trace, he would actually just paint where he wanted a particular color to be in a kind of what we call screen block, which is like a kind of burgundy pigment, a bit like gouache. And so he would build up the image in his mind. He wouldn't have any composite that he could look at to go, oh, I'll put a bit of green there. It was all in his head, which is incredible. And the only time he would see the combination of the colors was if he would scan each layer in and use Photoshop, as I've done, to show the different colors at the top and then overlay them digitally. That's the only way that he could actually see it. So he doesn't. He just waits for it to be printed. So this is shows you the buildup of the ink. Now, I remember I told you that litho ink is transparent. So when we used the light blue, you can see you can't really see very much light blue. It all looks green. But that's because he's deliberately placed the light blue and the yellow overlapping each other to get green. And the little bits of blue that do come through are quite, you know, sparing. And then when you see the darkest areas that look almost black, that's where all of the colors are one over the top of each other. And that is where we see the densest concentration of ink in the whole image. So we're seeing somebody using, you know, their mind like Photoshop. It's kind of amazing. And it's, again, it's something that is almost anachronistic, doing your own separations. But it's something that we do because it does look, it just looks different, and it you get something that you wouldn't get any other way. And case in point with this book, which is called A Graphic Cosmogony, this is how we printed and made this book and asked all of the artists to work in different spot colour separations, and it just gives a slightly different effect to conventional printing. The other thing is that it uses a hell of a lot more ink, actually. Now, we use vegetable-based ink, but even that has a very pungent smell, especially when there's a lot of it. So it's all, a lot of people have, you know, commented that our books smell good. They actually do, except when you've got, you know, like 3,000 copies sort of in your studio that have just been delivered by the printer, which is what used to happen before we had a warehouse. And that's all well and good until you go home and you have very strange dreams, because the smell is kind of probably, I don't know, it's a bit like sniffing glue. But it's worth it. So just quickly wanted to explain Flying Eye Books a little bit. Nobrow is the kind of umbrella imprint. So we published quite a few titles under Nobrow in the early days, which were intended to be children's books. We found it really difficult to market those books specifically to children's book buyers and to children in the end, because a lot of people looked at us and thought we were a kind of adult imprint, and just didn't really consider our books for their children's department. And after some time, we got increasingly kind of frustrated by this. I mean, once we have a comic book by Luke Pearson called Hilda, which is meant to be for kids, really. And I went into a large chain bookstore, which I won't name, but Hilda was on it was in the graphic novel department, and it was on a shelf alongside some horrific kind of, you know, sadomasochistic sex comic, kind of something that you wouldn't let your kid, you know, anywhere near. And yet it was just there on the same shelf. It just seemed completely bonkers that they would be in the same place in the shop. And so I went across to the children's department and I said to someone working in the children's department, you know, why is Hilda, you know, over there? We should be in the children's department. He said, oh, yeah, we don't do the buying for the graphic novel department. So I said, yeah, but why is Hilda oh, we don't do the buying for the graphic novel department. I could tell I wasn't going to get very far. So I basically moved Hilda when she wasn't looking to the shelf with Moomin and Tintin. And, you know, I felt much happier about that until I went home. And I thought, I can't do that in every bookshop in the country. It's just not productive. So Flying Eye Books came out of a wish to really, and an understanding finally that, you know, yes, we need to market to the trade in the correct way. And if we're not communicating properly with the trade, then we're not going to get very far. And one of the simplest ways of doing that is to create an imprint which is for a specific market. And so Flying Eye Books is for children. And it's for children's book buyers. They know that if they buy a Flying Eye Book, it's for their market. They're not going to get a copy of one of our other books which has got rude and naughty things in it by mistake. It's going to get into the hands of the wrong person, and then it's going to make the front page of the Daily Mail, and then we're all going to be in trouble. So that's not going to happen now that we've got Flying Eye Books. So that's what we do. And I only wanted to mention a couple of things about, but Wild, which you have to have a look at, is by Emily Hughes, has been one of our most successful books to date. And also Shackleton's Journey by William Grill, which this year, I'm not somebody who bangs on about prizes, except now, which I'm going to bang on about this one, because we won the Philip Carnegie and Kate Greenaway. We won the Kate Greenaway Prize for children's literature, which is kind of like winning an Oscar for it's the biggest prize for children's books. And for someone to win it for their first book is kind of astonishing. And when I also think that this was one of the first books, along with Wild, that we actually commissioned for Flying Eye Books, I sort of feel like we hit the jackpot, and now where can we go from here? It's going to be kind of depressing for the rest of my life. But seriously, we're very proud of having this book on our list this year, last year in fact, and having it win is kind of amazing. So and I think that a big part of it came from, in a way, not fully understanding the children's market to the extent that we did things a bit differently. And you know, Shackleton's Journey is big. It's a big book. It's got a cloth spine. It's got lots of kind of fancy print techniques on the cover. It's a non-fiction book, and it's illustrated. It's almost like a graphic novel. And all of these things, when we did this book, weren't necessarily staples of children's book or children's picture books. So yeah, it's a testament to maybe thinking about the book as an object and approaching it in that sense each time, which is something that we always try and do. And finally, it's not for ages, but next year in June we'll have the East London Comics and Arts Festival, where you can come and have a look at all kinds of different books, zines, comics, self-published things, small publishers, big publishers. It's a celebration of all things comics and arts, and it's it will be in East London. So come and have a look at that. And that's about it. So thank you very much. That's Hilda, by the way. And incidentally, I brought loads of postcards which you can take for free. So they're on this table here at the end.
I just wanted to see if anyone had any questions. I actually have a question. I just wanted to know how you went from, I guess, working on music videos and working in advertising to setting up your own publishing house.
Painfully and joyously. I don't know, really. I think that from my perspective, I was always telling stories with pictures, and all I've really done is change the medium of the stories in the pictures. So even though it seems different, it's not radically different to me. And also I think that at the time, I think I just needed a bit of a change from what I was doing. A couple of the last jobs that I did were for Coca-Cola and a really big supermarket. And although I actually earned really good money from those jobs, I think I felt like I could do something different with the rest of my life, and probably use some of the money that I'd earned to do it. Probably. Yeah, there we go. I'm trying to be really diplomatic because I'm on camera.
Anyone else? Okay, well, I'd just like to thank you, Sam, again for coming in.
My pleasure.
And talking about all these amazing books. And I would invite everyone to look at the books in the back and also pick up some of these amazing postcards.
And incidentally, that is actually the best way of me explaining to you what we do, is just to show you the books, which are kind of over there. But have the postcards too, because I brought them all away from Shoreditch and I don't want to take them back.
Thank you very much.